Hello everyone, welcome back to Seeker Plus. I'm your host, Julian Huguet, and I want to ask, what does the 4th of July mean to you? Well, if you're an American, it probably brings to mind backyard cookouts and fireworks. If you're not American, it's probably a pretty unremarkable date. But no matter where you live in the world, July 4th, 2012 was an important day for you, even if you don't know it. On that day, the European Organization for Nuclear Research, better known as CERN, announced they had evidence of a particle that was likely the long-theorized Higgs boson, often referred to in the news media as the God particle. We're coming up on the 10th anniversary of its discovery, so I wanted to take a more in-depth look at the Higgs boson. In this series, we're going to talk about how scientists even knew to look for it, how they found it, and what it means for the future of particle physics. But first, let's talk about that nickname. The God particle, a moniker many physicists absolutely hate. Sure, it's a sexy name, it looks good on a headline or a YouTube title, and it's also led people to think that maybe the discovery of the Higgs boson has something to do with the search for God. But it doesn't. Its discovery isn't evidence of any sort of higher being, and it's not why scientists were searching for it. In fact, the nickname was sort of a joke. See, finding this particle took nearly 50 years and the most complex machine humankind has ever built. It was such an elusive thing that one physicist, Nobel laureate Leon Lederman, called it the goddamn particle. That's what he was going to call his 1993 book about it, but the publisher didn't like that, so he dropped the damn from the title. The book was a hit, the name stuck, and now physicists have to keep correcting people about it forever. Now, before you go accusing me of using that for clickbait in the title, one, don't blame me, blame Leon Lederman's publisher, and two, well, you're absolutely right. But hey, I made a point to clear it up right away. That counts for something, right? The particle's discovery may not resolve the debate about God, but it was nonetheless a huge advancement for our understanding of the universe. The Higgs boson made the behavior of other particles we've discovered make sense. It explained how atoms could exist and how stars could shine. It was the last big piece of a fantastically complex jigsaw puzzle, and it's not like scientists had a picture on a box to guide them. So how did they know to look for it? Before diving in, though, I have to give you a primer on particle physics so we're all on the same page. But don't worry, it's going to be totally easy. Partly because I am going to oversimplify just a bit. But hey, by the end, you'll be like a mini expert on the subject. Think of how fun you'll be at parties. Okay, ready? I mentioned the Higgs boson was the last piece of a puzzle. And in a literal sense, that's true. It was the last particle predicted by the Standard Model of Particle Physics, which is our framework for organizing and describing elementary particles. You know how the periodic table of elements arranges chemical elements basically based on how big they are and how they behave? Well, the Standard Model is like that, but with particles even smaller and more fundamental than atoms. The Standard Model is split into two main groups. One group is the fermions, which are particles like electrons, and quarks, the building blocks of protons and neutrons. The other group is the bosons, which particles use to exchange energy with each other. You can think of bosons as the carriers of the four fundamental forces of nature. Well, maybe they carry all four, but definitely three. Photons, the particles that we can see as light, carry the electromagnetic force. Gluons carry the strong nuclear force, they're what binds those quarks together into protons and neutrons, and they're also what binds protons and neutrons together in an atom's nucleus. It's like they glue everything together, so you get it, gluons. The weak nuclear force is carried by W and Z bosons, and it causes subatomic particles to decay into other particles. And there's a hypothetical boson called the graviton, which could be responsible for gravity, but we haven't found it yet. Photons, gluons, and the W and Z bosons are called gauge bosons. Then there's the Higgs boson, which is special. It's not the boson itself that's so important, but its existence points to something larger that solves a big problem with the Standard Model. Now, you may have noticed that two of the forces carried by bosons have the word nuclear in them, the strong nuclear force and the weak nuclear force. That's because they only work over incredibly short distances within the nucleus of an atom. The other two forces, electromagnetism and gravity, are extremely long-ranged. That's because photons and the hypothetical gravitons have no mass, and Einstein tells us that if something has no mass, it must travel at the speed of light. Why two forces can travel across the universe while the other two can't make it outside of an atom was a huge mystery for physicists, and it even caused some serious drama. In 1954, one physicist, C.N. Yang, gave a lecture arguing that all forces could arise from a concept called symmetry, which I'll spare you, don't worry, I'm not going to get into because I think we already are hitting the limit of how much jargon I can put in one episode. Anyway, renowned physicist Wolfgang Pauli was in attendance, and he kept pestering Yang. Pauli knew that Yang's explanation of attributing all forces to symmetries meant all bosons wouldn't have a mass, and would therefore have unlimited range. Pauli knew that wasn't the case, so Yang's idea couldn't work. He shouted at Yang repeatedly, "What is the mass?" And when Yang said, it's complicated, and he and his colleague Robert Mills just couldn't figure it out, Pauli told him that wasn't a good enough answer. Yang got so flustered he actually stopped his lecture halfway through, and then he just took a seat. Yang and Mills, though, would end up getting the last laugh, because it turns out their idea of symmetries giving rise to forces was actually right. Their 1954 paper about this concept was the starting point for the Standard Model, and many years later it was discovered that gluons actually don't have a mass, but they interact with each other and form something like a big ball of quantum yarn that's confined to an atom's nucleus. The weak nuclear force, though, is different. And amazingly, we were put on the right track to figuring it out by a couple of guys who were just kind of making stuff up. You see, a neutron can decay into a proton, and likewise, a proton can change into a neutron, which is a really important step in nuclear fusion, the process that powers stars. This is where the weak force comes in. Scientists needed to explain how a neutron, which, as the name suggests, has a neutral electric charge, could change into a positively charged proton and vice versa. So in 1957, a physicist and Harvard professor named Julian Schwinger made up the W bosons pretty much out of thin air. He didn't have any evidence that they existed, he just came up with a concept that seemed to work. Here's Schwinger's idea. When a neutron decays, one of the quarks it's made of changes, emitting a negatively charged W- boson, and thus conserving the overall charge. The W- boson quickly decays into an electron and an antineutrino. Protons are the same, just flip all the minus signs to plus signs. To explain the W boson's short range, he gave it a mass, which again, he just made up, because he knew the weak force had a short range, but he didn't derive it mathematically. He also combined the electromagnetic force and the weak force, creating what Pakistani physicist Abdus Salam would later dub the electroweak force. By the time Schwinger's paper was published, though, famous physicist C.S. Wu had already performed a groundbreaking experiment that showed, for the first time, that a kind of symmetry could be broken, which meant symmetry could still give rise to the weak force, but allow the bosons to have a mass. Wu's experiment also showed the weak and electromagnetic forces couldn't be joined the way Schwinger suggested. Schwinger didn't let go of his idea. Instead, he did what any great professor does. He gave the problem to his grad student Sheldon Glashow. Glashow figured he could make the two forces reconcile by inventing yet another particle, the neutral Z boson. And again, there was no evidence of W and Z bosons. They wouldn't be discovered for another 20 years. But hey, making up bosons, just claiming they have a mass, that's all well and good, right? Who doesn't do that for fun? But at some point, someone is going to have to explain where that mass comes from. What exactly is breaking symmetry? In 1964, six different scientists all landed on the answer within months of each other. They suggested that there might be some sort of field present at all times and permeating the entire universe. This field could interact with bosons, giving them mass and slowing them down. Peter Higgs was one of those scientists, and although he wasn't the first to come up with the concept, he took it a little further. After his paper was initially rejected, Higgs submitted it to another journal with a couple of added paragraphs stating it should be possible to excite this field and create a particle. That's right, because of a minor rewrite, he suggested what we now call the Higgs boson. Although Peter Higgs himself doesn't seem too fond of the name. He refers to it as the so-called Higgs boson, and to credit the other physicists who independently came up with the same idea, he proposed using their initials and calling it the Higgs mechanism. Can't imagine why it didn't stick. Here's the thing, though. When those six scientists proposed this mechanism, none of them realized how important it would be. They were all trying to solve an entirely different problem and get around something called the Goldstone Theorem that stated even when symmetries are broken, you should still get a massless particle, which would have shown up in experiments by that point. A field rectified that, and the scientists suggested, maybe it could explain the strong force too. And that was it. Nobody really took notice. The major breakthrough came 3 years later when a physicist named Steven Weinberg put it all together. Weinberg was trying to explain the strong force with this field and give mass to gluons, not knowing as we know now that they're massless, so he was getting nowhere. Then one day, Weinberg was cruising along in his Camaro when it hit him. What if instead of focusing on the strong force, he used this field to explain the short range of the weak force instead? What if it gave mass to the W boson? And I have to emphasize, at this time, almost no one took the idea of W boson seriously. But Schwinger realized that the ideas fit together perfectly and could unify the electromagnetic and weak forces after all. It remains, I am certain, the most intelligent thing anyone has ever done in a Camaro, which usually involves jumping off of ramps into hay bales. And what was the physics world reaction to this earth-shattering revelation? Crickets. The idea finally started gaining traction in 1971 when another scientist showed that it all made mathematical sense. Soon the first hints of the Z boson were seen, and Weinberg's paper, which mistakenly credits Higgs first among the six scientists, quickly became the most cited paper in high energy physics and would be for the next 30 years. Hopefully, I've made it easy now to see why. Suddenly, this hypothetical field could make everything work together beautifully. It could even explain the mass of other particles like electrons and quarks. And because of the particle Higgs proposed, it was actually possible to confirm if it existed. We just had to find the Higgs. The standard model was starting to take shape, and the path forward for the next 40 years of particle physics was set. But how does one go about finding a new particle? By smashing particles together at nearly the speed of light, that's how! And we'll talk about that on the next episode of Seeker Plus. I just want to say, if you made it this far, congrats. We covered a lot of ground at nearly light speed, and honestly, I barely skimmed the surface. The next video is going to be less concept heavy. It's going to be about fun stuff like smashing atoms. So if you want even more in-depth talk of particles and quantum stuff like this, let us know in the comments and be sure to subscribe. I'll see you for the next Seeker Plus.